Good evening. I've tried Stormgate since it became playable again for the public and would like to give my feedback as well as some bug reports. I'm sorry for some background noise and some poor video editing. It has been years since I last used After Effects. Currently, it is inconvenient to try and figure out how much remaining resources there's left for you to mine. With Therium, there is currently not even a value at all to see how much is left. The option to always display remaining resources, not just when resource nodes are highlighted, would be appreciated. The reason why I think this is something that should be considered is that the resource nodes in multiplayer has a somewhat short lifespan before they are mined dry, and it is important for Infernals, for instance, to place expansions ahead of time because they cannot speedball structures like Vanguard or remote mine resources like Celestials. Therium nodes currently does not disappear once it is mined completely to exhaustion, so workers will not be marked as idle despite not actually mining anything. Removing the Therium node once it is mined dry would help to avoid hiding secretly idle workers. Currently, the Therium expands willy-nilly around the node. It is fine aesthetically to have some randomness to add visual flair, but after having played co-op and some few custom matches now, I've had problems several times with workers not placing structures because I tried to place the structure, but it was blocked because Therium nodes expanded a little bit too far behind Fog of War. A no structure zone similar to Luminite mines around it would help. Currently, what we have is out-of-date wikis on the internet and learn-to-play that leads to community-made videos that take 2 minutes to get out of the content creator's intros. Using the Codex would help to provide some information about units and structure statistics, abilities, and very easy-to-miss quirks. The campaign is likely fine, being left to explore, but multiplayer and co-op, where players are interested in spending maybe hundreds of hours in, it would help to provide at least some basic wiki in-game. I looked through the news sections on Steam briefly and saw that rebinding hotkeys is on the to-do list. Looking forward to that when it comes. I am hopeful about modding in the future, and while I certainly do appreciate the convenience features of universal unit training, structure building and research tabs, I am of the opinion that there are too few button slots currently in the command card. I understand the logic of why there is only 2 rows of buttons, but if possible, at the very least for modding, adding the option to expand it to 3 rows as has been the staple for RTS games would be appreciated. I will give an example later in the video, with the Celestial Arcship about why I think this is too few buttons. It would be greatly appreciated to have hotkeys to cycle between mining outposts, similar to existing RTS titles. Currently, Infernals consistently sacrifice workers, and Celestial's alien base management have flying workers and structures placed who knows where. Being able to cycle between bases with a hotkey to see if you are missing workers or if your bases are about to run dry of resources would make economy management easier. Currently, there are units with abilities that are greatly subjective in whether or not to have autocast enabled by default. More skilled players would likely prefer to manually cast certain abilities that could turn the battle. Untap to decide if newly created units have autocast enabled by default or not would remove needless busywork. Well, I absolutely love the current easy convenience build structure feature. I would appreciate if it was possible to cancel planned structures. There has been more than once that I have placed the wrong structure and tried to find out which space the workers are approaching from so I could correct it. Being able to right-click on the outlined blueprint to interrupt the wrong or misplaced structures would be greatly appreciated. Also, in Vanguard's case, being able to left-click to add more workers would be nifty as well to speed-build structures. Currently, I have predominantly played co-op, and one thing I would greatly appreciate is the option to decide my own allied, neutral, and enemy army colors. Multiple people being able to play the same co-op faction will drastically reduce queue time, but keeping you from color-coding specific commander's factions. When I have played multiple co-op matches where players' colors constantly get rotated and see different blockade heroes, it gets difficult to keep track of if it is an allied hero that is about to die that I can heal, or if it is my own character that I cannot heal and is near death. Being able to choose your own color, and if possible, team member 2 and 3's color from your own perspective would help a lot. Currently, it is difficult to eyeball weapon range, and I have no idea how far some abilities can go, or for that sake what radius they can affect units in. Having circles to indicate how far abilities can be cast, and how long range weapons can reach, such as sabers, atlases, and hellborn, would help to gauge to see where I can place them to make the best use of terrain. I've tried to find the middle ground between the interface scale adjustment, but I've had some irritation with the user interface covering a bit too much of the screen while simultaneously struggling to see what is on the map. I can see buttons, selected units and other elements clearly, but I struggle to see if enemies are approaching on the map. A separate slider for the map and the rest would be appreciated. Currently, the game supports spellcasting on friendly units through clicking on the portrait in the selected unit display, including the Unload All spell on evac, which is fantastic. I would appreciate a somewhat similar feature in being able to load up units into structures or dropships through right-clicking on their portrait, or alternatively, using the load ability on cargo capacity units and buildings to load selected units into cargo capacity entities. Stormgate is a moderately fast RTS game where micromanaging units is a major key to victory. I have, however, had some problems over the years with using more than a single dropship, because right-clicking on the dropship moves all units to the dropship, including other aerial units. The aerial units are stacked onto each other, and the dropship will move erratically back and forth, making it difficult to load up units into the ship, which is very inconvenient for dropship action, which is highly dependent on unit control. Either right-clicking on selected dropship, or using the load ability onto dropship in order to orderly and more easily pick up units would be more appreciated. Also, a small quirk I noticed with this, for the people who have never used Unload All through the Selected Units tab. Currently, the dropship will unload onto the location of the targeted unit if the unit has no units in its cargo, which will cause the dropship to move to the unit that Unload All has been cast on an unload unit, which includes other empty dropships. Currently, units in a control group will be removed from the control group when they are loaded into cargo units, both dropships and structures. Currently, small creatures' shadows will disappear on high and medium visual quality, depending on the camera position and if you are zoomed in or not. Well, it is not a big problem. It left me confused the first time I saw co-op commander Malloc using Fellhawk Blitz, initially thinking that it was flying units because I saw no shadows. Currently, when you hold down a button, the game will not repeat its action. Hypothetically, I want to mass produce a cheap unit, and I want to do it often. Throughout a 20-minute ladder match, it gets tedious to create them. Not having to go back to base and repeat the action process, but having to click 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 12 times every time to keep the production going. I want base management, and I want resource management. With the scale of Stormgate battles and unit counts, however, a whole load of units will have to be produced consistently, and it would be a welcome change to have the repeat action, similar to holding down a character in a Word document, resulting in letters repeating. Also, spell confirmation with the same button as the spell it is tied to. Push the spell button and confirm with the same one. Well, it is not common to spam spells in Stormgate due to units' relatively small energy pool. There are certain spells that would be lovely to have the potential to spam. Celestial's Cabal has the Liberation and Gravity Flux. Both have the autocast option, but it would be a waste to spend 55 energy to slow movement, reduce damage, slow attack speed, and stun a singular infernal fiend. Vanguard's Sentinel ability, Stasis Drone, which puts units in a cage, would also be potentially interesting to mass cast on important units. Infernal's Hexen also have the Venom Mine ability that you can use. If you have 6 of them and want to spend all of their energy with creating a minefield, you could hold down Shift and queue up the ability repeatedly. Queue the move command and move to an energy shrine to repeat the same action elsewhere. That is possible, but it would be a lot more time efficient to be able to rapid spam it by holding down the button and wiggle the mouse back and forth to create a minefield. Currently, it would be extremely difficult to mass cast spells onto enemy units. First, trying to spam left click will eventually cause you to click on an enemy or a different friendly unit, losing control of your spell caster until you select it again. Secondly, you will be limited to your own APM. Automation is a dreaded word among RTS enthusiasts, but hopefully this suggestion is something that will resonate with people. The repeat spam option being enough of a decision-making thing will reducing the actions per minute without dumbing down the game. Last feedback before going into factions and co-op. people have in the past been extremely skeptical about too much automation, so I hope this will not be too much for purists, and I hope those that feel so speak out in the comment section. What I request would be to queue up structures and units you do not have the resources for prematurely and let them construct and or train when the resources are available. Stormgate is a resource management game where you have to manage what to create and when. This suggestion of prematurely queuing up units and structures is something that will hopefully bridge the gap between automation and decision making. Over the years, I've been a little bit irritated over whack-a-moling the production line when the resources are available, or waiting for the moment I have enough resources for a structure, then place it. If someone were to queue up 100 lancers, they will be resource-starved and unable to produce, for instance, atlases or vulcans. In contrast, if you're waiting for Therium while being interested in producing the new helicarrier or something else expensive like a structure, it will be made when you have the resources. It is even more so irritating with Infernals that currently has charges on their structures for unit production. The goal of this suggestion is to retain resource management decision aspect while also giving more room for players to focus on a battlefield, moving units and fighting and scouting without dumbing down the game. If this is too much automation in any of your opinion, if this should be relegated to the BuddyBot feature, or if this is something that would be welcome in a multiplayer, then again, please say so in the comment section, so that if the Stormgate developers read this, they can factor that into their decision making. Currently, the co-op has a tutorial that provides some of the basics to play the game, as well as an area to test things out in practice, where you can file and try again. It is currently by default set to queue up with others. The solo option button, as well as BuddyBot, is partially bugged. Hovering over them without pressing them will not provide text about them until you press them. The reason why I see this as a problem is for new players with social anxiety that will feel pressured to move on instead of familiarizing themselves with the game, the whole point about tutorials. Make the tutorial by default solo will hopefully give Stormgate an easier introduction for new players. Part of the appeal of different commanders is that they provide some twist or quirk that will appeal to different players with fresh playstyles through new units and mechanics to existing factions. Malak is pure destruction, bombastic ground forces and heavy units, with swarms of fiends and fellhogs, led by a spellcaster from behind. In contrast to Wars, that is a mix of ground and air that debuffs enemies to make them easier to kill, led by an aggressive killing machine melee commander. Currently, only Blockade has the option for you to explore him in the tutorial. On playground tutorial like Blockade's, for experimentation and figuring out other commanders would hopefully make the game more approachable for new players. Part of why I view this as something that should be prioritized is because of Celestial Armada. Celestial Armada is an utterly alien faction that deviates from what RTS players has been used to for decades. The central headquarter of the faction is able to move and is, excluding the hero, the only way to heal units. The faction has to build supplies for structures but not units. You can build anywhere where you have power field without workers, plus morphcore build anywhere option. This is not bad, I like the faction, but throwing you in with other players and being anxious about not being a detriment to them, which will cause new players to rush without having time to familiarize themselves with factions that is utterly alien to decades of established expectations of the genre, is bound to be too much for some and drive away players that might otherwise have loved the game. A mini campaign level of polish is not necessary. Just a tutorial playground for players to get familiar with the faction, similar to what Blockade has. The tutorial should be separate from difficulty, so that it is clear that it exists as a tutorial. Slightly move the bottom bar here, and there is more than enough space. You could also place it under here, or anywhere else. There is plenty of space. The buttons, BuddyBot and Matchmaking will not display their text until you've clicked on them once after having started the game. Currently, co-op's lower level difficulties are way too hard. There are 8 difficulties for new players unfamiliar with the genre that want to get into RTS. Currently, there is way too little time to amass an army, construct defenses, and prepare for short response times on semi-spontaneous events. I barely have time to attack an enemy before a new convoy comes along, which we have to stop or lose the game. I can handle it, but new players cannot. There are 8 difficulties. Make the lowest one approachable for people who have never touched the genre, and let the upper ones be a bloodbath. In my opinion, here are what should not be in the lowest difficulties. Flying units in attack waves on bases. Infernals barely have anything but guns to attack early on, and they are hardly accessible as a retroactive response since Infernals' structures operates with charges. Stealthed moving objectives, because commanders like Malloc has no mobile detection period. I only discovered by accident that you could reveal it with an area of effect spell. Base stomping mini-bosses in attack waves that are capable of destroying a player on their own. Objectives should be way more lenient with time limits and failures before losing the match. Moving objectives that has to be destroyed should be slower. A timer for when a new attack wave is approaching. Not let enemy attack waves attack multiple positions simultaneously. New players are not able to split and focus on multiple fronts. Absolutely add quirks, difficulties, ambushes, mutators and more on higher difficulties where people crave challenges you have to adapt to. But the game will lose a massive amount of fresh potential players that will be turned off from the current quote-unquote beginner difficulty. Currently, the game will randomly give you a different difficulty choice than what you choose when you actually enter the match. So, I was going to say in the original script that this was written before the recent patch and that previously when placing buildings, army units was not ordered away aggressively enough, causing workers to not build structures. But it seemed that the latest patch had somewhat resolved this silently, because I could not replicate the previous problem. This I think is still true, but when I tried to make a clip of this happening, the workers seemed to place the structure, then just go away. If this clip will somehow find any trouble with the game, then neat, because I am not entirely sure what just happened. Currently, the solar habitat will automatically empower the nearest structure it is placed to, regardless of whether it will boost anything or not. It would be great if it could filter out only targeting structures that would benefit from it. Also, a structure can only benefit from one power-up, but you can focus multiple solar habitats onto one structure. It would also be neat if, without autocast enabled, it would stick onto what you want to focus on, but with autocast enabled on solar habitat, it would shift between empowering active structures, such as switching between active production structures until they stop producing stuff, and boost the other active structures, or shift over to, for instance, ramparts when it is recharging its energy. And having a priority button that automatically shifts to prioritize unit production or sentry outpost when they start attacking, followed up by recharging ramparts energy when sentry posts are not attacking and ramparts need energy recharged. I love the modular sentry post, but currently they are clunky. Buttons on the sentry post to request nearby unit of different types to occupy it would make things easier, in one button ejecting the existing unit, then request a nearby unit of your desire to take its place. This is a skill issue, but currently if you queue up multiple structures, there is a chance for bobs to get stuck within it. While some workers getting stuck are poor base management, it would be great if the game would request workers to move if they occupy spaces like this. Initially, I was going to report that Ritual Chamber's tooltip did not mention that it was the requirement for Hexen, but the video took so long to make that I fixed this. One of Malak's abilities are to turn multiple corpses into burned one units, which gets more powerful the more corpses you consume in one cast. The problem is that I can't see where corpses are, or figure out what lives behind a corpse. An indicator of sort, placeholder arrow if necessary, would be great. One of Malak's top power abilities is Fellhog Blitz. It creates new pigs and sends them to attack a position. One possible bug, however, is that they retain ordinary Fellhog's supply provision effect until they die at least. If this is a bug to be fixed or a happy accident is for you to decide. Currently I have from time to time experienced a strange kind of performance issue that I have some problems with replicating, in that during large fights, usually when attacking bases where all three players' armies are attacking something at the same time, I experience cumulatively increasing delay in command response, For every second that passes as large armies are attacking, I get around half a second longer response time from units that I try to order. Not graphical lags or units acting independently. The units attack perfectly fine, the autocast spells no lag, but the orders I give are significantly delayed. If I refrain from attacking and let my army stand idle, then the delay goes down over time. I have had problems with replicating this, but the closest consistent result I have gotten is that playing wars and fighting with large quantities of Void Brutes, around 30 or more. I've tried to fight with large armies with other factions without getting the same result, or at least nowhere nearly as severe as with wars Void Brutes. Currently, the Archship suffers from the two grid panel choice the game operates with. Most other moving units in the game has attack move and stop command. Archships lack the control panel space to let you have all of those abilities. Currently, it produces Prism Walkers with the A button and Morph Corps with the S button. I implore every Celestial Armada enthusiast to speak out against what I am about to suggest if you disagree with this. A problem I experience is that I keep pressing A to attack move out of habit when moving non-workers, and S because I want them to stop. I keep accidentally producing workers. Currently, Arcships upgrade to Arc Stations button is occupied by the B slot by default. When upgraded, the same slot is replaced by Upgrade to Arc Fortress. When it is finally upgraded to Arc Fortress, the button is vacant and the Arc Fortress gained the Fate's End beam by default on C, which has been empty this whole time. The Arc ship also has the Build Structure on set, which lets it construct buildings. Functionally, this makes absolutely no difference from the Build Structure button above the ship. The Arc ship does nothing but provide a power field that lets you place buildings there. That is a core feature of the Celestial Armada. With the power field, no worker is required. What if the Build Structure button, which effectively serves no purpose, was removed? The Upgrade Structure and Fate's End ability button occupied the same slot, and we moved Fabricate Prism and Fabricate Morph Core to the bottom panel in order to let the Archship have stop command as well as attack command. While the ship has no attack, it has the healing ability. Adding the Attack Move button would let the structure cast its healing ability automatically on the move to heal injured units without having to use hold position or using move command to stop the ship to heal injured units. Currently, the designers try to keep a simple, easily understandable logic layout where unit production location and upgrade locations are stored in the same slot, both in the structure themselves and in the universal access tab. Moving the button around in the Arc ship would leave the Creation Chamber and Guardian Nexus first two slots free for eventual future basic units that might get added into the game. For Celestial Armada players, are you too used to the current placement of structure buttons? Would this be an unwelcome frustration for you if this was changed? Or is this something that sounds appealing to you? If you strongly feel for or against this, by all means say so in the comment section. Currently, the Ark ship has the option to place rally points that is shared among Prism and Morph goals. You can place this on the resources to set a rally point as you might expect. The Prism does not even need a collection array in order to mine Luminite, remotely harvesting from mines instead of returning to a structure with it, unlike Therium, which I discovered by accident then when testing this. It does, however, not set rally points onto the mine if you accidentally click on the collection array, instead deciding to move the Ark ship without setting a new rally point. The same is not true for Prism workers, thankfully. They will be assigned to work if you click on the mine or the collection array. Arguably, the core purpose of the scanner is to be placed onto a tree and provide scouting. Currently, I have difficulty with telling what qualifies as a tree and what does not. Some form of ground highlight would be appreciated to distinguish compatible terrain for the perch ability from unintended background details. Currently, morph cores and prisms are both labeled as workers. Morph cores are situational late-game structures in the game that I produce because I want them idle for plans like secret structure placements. I do not want it to be tied to select all army button, but I also do not want it to be tied to idle workers. A separate button for idle morph cores would be swell. In the original script, I was going to comment on that for some reason, creating an Ark ship from Morph Cores costed 100 less Luminite than creating it from the power field. That has since been updated. A minor quirk with Ark ship's AI when clicking on neutral towers outside of Fog of War. For some reason, when I right-click on a creep tower outside of vision range, the Ark ship will not move. If the Ark ship already has a move command and moved some distance, it will move back to where it originally stood if I right click on a tower with it. This only applies to towers outside of vision range. As I try to get footage of what I'm talking about, I came across what will hopefully bring more clarity than questions. The Ark ship and Ark fortress both have this quirk, with that they will go back to their original position if moved, and refuse to move if idle and ordered to move to a tower outside of vision range. The Ark station, however, for some reason does not share this behavior. Both Ark ship and Ark fortress will display a red pointer on the ground similar to when attacking enemies, which ordinary units does not when ordered to move to a tower. I was not in a beta before it was open to the public, but I believe that the ship had the option to move and had a weapon to attack with if it was placed on the ground. This could be a leftover behavior from when the Ark ship and equals had an attack option, which was only properly removed from the Ark station. Currently, with the Celestial Armada's glittery gold and shine team, it is difficult to see what is under the effect of Power Surge. Celestial Armada players might get used to it, but it will be more difficult for Infernals and Vanguard players that have spent less time looking at the structures. Determining if Guardian Nexus is searched to provide armor for nearby buildings, or Ascension Matrix is providing damage bonus to units. I was looking over them and noticed that the tiles under the structures turn into a muted brown while searched. So far, the Stormgate team has communicated that they take the graphics and style criticism seriously, so there likely is long-term plans to change or upgrade the graphics. But a minor band-aid solution could be to turn the floor around the structure more vibrant, standing out more, instead of adding more flash onto the structure that already has no shortage of shine. Currently, it is difficult to tell if a link node has been upgraded to a defensive structure, or if it is just under the effect of Surge. You can't simply add a color-coded crystal to it, because it could be confused with a different player structure, and adding more shine will just cause more confusion with the existing Surge sparkles. Hopefully it will be a long-term thing that will eventually be resolved if there are any major graphics overhaul planned. The closest thing I can suggest would be to have the fighting with light and darkness thing that was marketed in the reveal by having one shiny light one and one darkness themed. Currently, it is nearly impossible to keep track of all structures with Surge active, and with the Celestial Armada's mobile team, it is encouraged to shift around the power as deemed necessary. For defense to power up turrets or power banks to increase energy regeneration, and when done, place the power back onto production structures around the map after having defended places. A button on the side to remove all surge effects on existing structures would hopefully make it a bit more convenient for players that want to play around with it to min-max power usage without placing unnecessary power banks. Currently, the Vector's command card button does not mention that the ability requires line of sight over where you want to blink. It would ease in confusion for new players if this was mentioned. I was going to report that the Vector's recall upgrade would cause the unit to teleport back after teleporting when the buff expired, regardless of whether the player used the ability again or not. But when I tried to get footage of it, I noticed that it is completely random if the unit is teleported back or not. I have not been able to pinpoint any logical pattern of why it does it, however. Vector's teleportation is currently malfunctioning in three ways. It currently struggles to teleport to a location where there are already units. If there are too many units there already, it will not be even bother to try and teleport. The second way it malfunctions is partially by design, because it requires line of sight to teleport somewhere. I assume that this is to prevent it from teleporting up cliffs where you do not have vision, but currently there are two outcomes. If the teleportation target has terrain or trees blocking its path, it will not even try to teleport. If it has no terrain or tree blocking it, it will move until it has line of sight and teleport where it has vision over the area. The third malfunction is if the return point is occupied. If occupied, the Vector will not teleport back. additional scenarios for who's in charge of looking over this. The vector will not teleport if units are clustered too tight. Two scenarios where I have been able to recreate the scenario. The closest solution I can suggest would be to give recalling vectors the worker mineral walk property briefly, where it will ignore other ground units' footprint, then disperse after a brief moment. The following is not a bug per se, but how I have used the ability in your previous game. I do not know exactly how the game is coded internally, but from my understanding, the game's engine tries to move multiple selected units together to an area around a point when it initially receives its orders. And afterward, if being queued with multiple orders, it leaves things a little bit more ambiguous instead of trying to follow as a group. How I have used this coding in the past to my advantage is to place two movement orders queued, one for the most convenient rallying ground and then a second one to loosen up the attempted organization. Queue a teleportation location and then an additional movement order to give the following teleporting units an area to teleport as well. This is how I have teleported masses of units in you-know-which multiplayer RTS game. I struggled initially in Stormgate, with the only problem being that I needed three initial movement orders for this to work properly. But beside that, it has been working smooth as butter, exactly as the your previous title. This script, along with playtesting to try and get consistent results, was done in a previous patch. I tried to get footage in the current patch after formulating my thoughts and what to say. Previously, I was able to get consistent results with loosening up unit formations. But after watching this, I noticed that some clusters of units collectively gave up on previous waypoints and proceeded toward the next one, which caused some trouble with what I tried to showcase here. In the previous patch, I was getting consistent, flawless results with this. The game currently has some performance issues, along with the odd extended delay in command response time in co-op, so I fully understand it if there are some wild experimentation with trying to improve the game. Hopefully the footage here has given some material to work with if more patch coding experimentation is being done. The reason why I know that something was changed in the code is because previously I tried to experiment with the teleportation ability in the previous patch and noticed that it malfunctioned if the area that unit was ordered to move to before teleporting was obscured by fog of war. It would simply not cast the spell and move toward the final. Currently, Aura Lana has a lifesteal beam ability, which has an autocast option. The problem, however, is that the lifesteal does not have a requirement that prevents it from being cast onto a target that is already under its effect. This is how I guess it is supposed to work. This is how it currently works. Hopefully, however it is supposed to work, it will be fixed in the future. Last subjective pet peeve. Aura Lana's healing ability, arguably her core ability, is not on autocast by default. If others' feedback is that it should not be autocast by default, or it is your design decision, then so be it. Throughout our attempt to record this, I've had problems with my PC forcibly restarting when alt-tabbing out of the game when in full screen mode. This could very well be on my end with an old PC and running different programs in the background, including fraps used to record this. If anyone has had the same problem with the PC forcibly restarting when alt-tabbing in full screen mode, then please report so in the comment section. If this is a recurring thing other people than me experience, then it could be related to the game and something that the developers should look into. A little bit of a rough start, but otherwise this so far is everything I hoped Stormgate was going to be. The unit pathing, for the most part, has exactly the smooth, responsive feeling I was hoping for. Factions feel unique from each other, from units to structures. Units has some moderation of abilities for high-skilled players to utilize and distinguish themselves with. Units has a middle ground between being worth micromanaging, while simultaneously all ultimately being expendable. Easily recognizable units and spells. I can see clearly which units are which, based on their surface design, movement and animations. Same with spells. There are no question about which spells are cast when they are cast. There has been no shortage of criticism about graphics, but unlike MMORPG raids, where the screen becomes an epileptic seizure-inducing storm of flashes, I can clearly see what is going on in Stormgate. Base production feels satisfying, with building placements mattering, while not overdoing it by requiring needlessly large quantities of structures. It is sandboxy enough for you to be creative in how you approach the game to win. No hand-holding with predetermined defenses. Freedom to cheese and harass. Micromanagement intensive units for people who want to make more than brute force units. Interesting features in the form of buddybot that still needs work but is something that might make the game more approachable for casuals. I've spent the time making this video because I like the game and I want to play more of it, being especially interested in its future with modding that I'm looking forward to get my hands onto. Hopefully I've provided enough feedback for you to work with, and thank you for the game that you've provided so far.